Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I pray you well. Let's start. Al-Fatiha. Rahman ar-Rahim, Malik. Yehdina s-sirat. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Allahumma salli wa sallim bi jami'i shu'uni fi dhuhuri al-butun ala Sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Allahumma allimna ma yanfa'una wa anfa'na bima 'allamtana wa zidna 'ilman wa 'amalan wa qurban ya arhamar rahimin. Allahumma akrimna wa la tuhinna wa a'tina wa la tahrimna wa athirna wa la tu'thir 'alaina wa ardina wa ardu 'anna. Ja, Arhabar Rahimin, Oya Akram al-Akramin, Oya Dhul Jalali wal-Ikram. So, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed us to look at this discussion. It's a brief discussion around around the event of Uhud before the detail comes in. So we're going to have much more coming in soon. But we looked at the verses regarding regarding the Battle of Badr and the victory and support that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the believers and the conditions that were there in order for those things to materialize, and the absence of them at Uhud, and then the discussion continued, and we ended with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanding the believers, wa ati'u Allah wa rasul, and obey Allah and the messenger. And so now what we have is a continuation of that discussion, or it can be seen as a separate discussion. So what we have is the verse. Let's look at this verse and go into it. وَسَارِعُوا إِلَىٰ مَغْفِرَةٍ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ وَجَنَّةٍ عَرْضُهَا السَّمَاوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضُ أُعِدَّتْ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. So what's being said, and hasten towards forgiveness from your Lord and a paradise as vast as the heavens and the earth prepared for those mindful of Allah. Right, subhanAllah. So right off the bat, there are two qira'at, two qira'as here. So two canonical variant recitations of the Quran. Both of them are considered to be Quran. So we have this one that we recite, sari'u ila maghfiratin min rabbikum, wasari'u. So it's as though Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, and obey Allah and obey the messenger and vie and compete with each other in this, right? In obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and compete with each other in attaining the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and this reward of paradise, and the, so this is a qira'ah of Hafs and Asim that we recite from. There are other qira'at. So Imam Nafi' and Ibn Amir recited it without a waw. So what does this mean? It means that the verse starts sari'u, right? So it's not it's just a new injunction. So obey Allah and His Messenger, and then that's finished. And so it's not a continuation of that, it's just a fresh injunction. Sari'u, compete with each other, vie with each other, right? Okay, so what's the verse saying? So it's saying, وَسَارِعُوا, and, so obey Allah and His Messenger, and sari'u, from sara'a, to be fast, you know, to race with each other. So the pattern mufa'ala here, what it means is to compete with each other, vie with each other, try to outdo and outstrip each other. Sari'u, you know, so try to outstrip each other. So this is healthy competition, right? What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is encouraging the believers to do. So what you'll find is whenever there's a lack of, when there's a challenge, there's always growth, right? And whenever there's a lack of challenge, there's stagnation, right? Which, so for example, in certain industries, certain countries have laws to prevent one company from buying everything. So you won't have, say, one pharmaceutical company owning everything, right? or the vast majority of products. Because this affects the quality of the product, because there's no challenge, there's no competition, so the general standard diminishes. But when there's competition, it promotes a healthy market, so each company will try to do its best, and the consumer benefits the most in that way. So monopolies, stunt that. So in the same thing, Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala is saying to the believers, vie and race with each other to the th in doing the good. Just like there are people out there that compete with each other in doing bad and doing the things that will only bring destruction and harm on themselves, Allah is telling the believers, you aim to outdo each other in pleasing your Lord. And that's the trick, to have this goal of wanting to do as much as you can to please Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, right? And it takes many forms. It takes many forms, right? And so that's the command. So for sari'u ila maghfiratin, so race and hasten and vie against each other to reach what? The maghfirah, the forgiveness, right? Powerful form, master mimi. The wording is strong in and of itself. It's indefinite to show it's a fantastic, huge, amazing, all-encompassing forgiveness, right? The mistakes of a lifetime. So obviously this is talking about the ultimate forgiveness in the Akhirah, where we know this because it's juxtaposed with it's coupled with the mention of paradise. So an absolute supreme forgiveness from your Lord, so he'll forgive all the mistakes and all the sins and everything of a lifetime, right? So how do you attain the forgiveness? So the ulama said that it's a metaphor for why to doing certain actions which lead to the forgiveness, right? So it's why to doing all of the things that please Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala and compete with each other in shunning all of the things that displease Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. So it's a broad statement. Anything that would lead to forgiveness, so anything that Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala has enjoined upon us, anything that is recommended in the religion, anything that is obligatory, all those things, right, compete with each other, right, to do the best. And this is a mindset some people are really driven, and they don't need to look at anyone else, and they just with focus and intent keep going forward. Others need encouragement, so this is it. So looking at each other, helping each other, encouraging each other like this helps others. So it says vie and compete with each other in towards in order so you can reach the forgiveness, right? So doing the good deeds that lead to the forgiveness, mirrabbikum, from your loving, caring master, your Lord, right? Your loving Lord. So it's interesting that maghfirah is indefinite, right? So we talked about maghfirah is forgiveness, but the root word also means that to protect, right? To cover and protect, i.e., from the consequences of one's bad actions, right? So, what makes it firstly, the word is indefinite, and the second, a masdar is used, and it's a masdar mimi, right? With a meme at the beginning, so like the ultimate forgiveness, just like you have tawbah, a masdar, and then you have matab, which is like the ultimate forgiveness, ultimate tawbah, and here the ultimate forgiveness. So it's huge and it's amazing in and of itself, and it has a further quality of being great and supreme and tremendous because it's from Rabbikum, your loving, caring Lord. So it's great in and of itself, and it's great because of who it's from and who it's connected to, right? And so that's a huge source of hope for us. So compete for that. وَجَنَّةٍ عَرْضُهَا السَّمَاوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضُ and a garden. We talked about Jannah before, so it's a garden. And anything with the word Jeem, Noon, Noon has a meaning of covering. So it's a lush, verdant meadow with, you know, there are trees, there are plants, and the vegetation, the foliage from the trees above, it covers everything below it in shade, right? So a beautiful environment. And he says, عرضها, its width is the heavens and the earth, right? So there's a couple of positions. Some of the ulama say its width is like the width of the heavens and the earth, and or that's one position. Or what? Because generally, like if you look at a building, right, the structure of the building, its width is going to be less than its height generally, right? If you, especially with tall buildings, right, skyscrapers, very clearly, right. So Arabs would use this as an expression, right, to show the vastness of something, to show like if its width is this much, then just think how much its height is going to be. That's one position. Another position is like Imam Al-Qaffal said that whenever the Arabs used a reference to width, what they mean is, what they mean is vastness, right? So they would use the word ard for sa'ah, for vastness. They would say biladun arida, wide, vast, wide lands, literally, but it means vast lands, right? So that's one of the meanings that they use it for. So compete with each other, hasten, don't delay, do whatever you can, right? And, you know, rush towards doing these things for this tremendous forgiveness and a Jannah, a garden. And he described its size in something just beyond what we can imagine, really. So he said its ard, it's, if we take it literally, its width is equivalent to the heavens and the earth. Now the earth is, as we know, very small, right, compared to even the size of the solar system. Compared to the universe, it's not even worth mentioning, right? But it's important and significant to us, and compared to our size, it's massive, right? That's why it's mentioned. And so, how big is this thing, right? You know, there's it's beyond imagining, you know, like you have the visible, so we have our universe, which would be the first sky, and then you have the second and the third and fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh. Each from the first sky compared to the second is like a ring thrown in a vast desert, as the Prophet told us, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Minuscule compared to something huge. The second compared to the third is just like that. The third compared to the fourth, and so on, right? So it's vast, unimaginable. Like light travels at, you know, 186,000 miles a second, or 300,000 kilometers per second. And so that distance that it would travel in a year is a light year, right? And just coming from the sun, it takes, that's 93 million miles away, it takes about 8 minutes to reach Earth. It's huge, right? And we're talking distances, even at 186,000 miles every second, it takes a second and a half for it to reach the moon and back. And so, even the most distant stars that we can see are roughly 33 billion light years away. So it would take light that much time to get there. And obviously the universe is still expanding as well. And that's just what we call the observable universe. And that's nothing, nothing compared to the actual universe, because not enough time has passed for the light from the furthest sources to actually reach us, because the distance is increasing as well. And so you've got this vast, vast area that we can't even imagine. Yeah, the brain just literally shuts down. Right? It's like trying to conceptualize infinity. Right? After a while, you can't. You can try. After a while, your brain just won't be able to fathom it. So it's this vast universe, and then the next one, and then the next one. With the great disparities, you know, really, you know, from one to the other, all of them, that's the vastness, the width, if we take that position, of paradise, of the garden. And Allah's created that for us. And now you can actually see just what people lose out on, because we know the hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari that the last believer to exit hell the place he gets, you know, just for himself, is 10 times the size of Earth. Now, what is 10 times the size of Earth when you're thinking about these sorts of distances, right? You know, not, you know, minuscule. So its width is that. And then he says, "U'iddat lil muttaqin," it's been prepared for the God-fearing, for those who do their best to shun the things God doesn't want, starting from shirk and disbelief, down to the major sins and the minor sins, and they do their best, and you know, they try to overcome the obstacles that would prevent them from doing so, and they try to get to this goal. It's a lifelong thing, right? You get there. It's not like a certificate you achieve and you can put it on your wall. No, it's something active, and it's being prepared. Just like earlier, he told us to, you know, be afraid of the fire that's been prepared for the disbelievers, lest any believer enter there. Here, it's been prepared for the muttaqeen. Anyone else that gets there, these people are the primary recipients of this garden, and they're who it's been made for. Anyone else, like, you know, the disobedient whose sins are forgiven, or those who don't know about religion and then they die and they enter paradise with an amnesty, they're there as you know, it's there, it's for them secondarily, but primarily for the muttaqeen. And then we understand from the verse that it's already in existence. And we understand from the verse that it's beyond the, you know, our universe and every the other skies that contain it. And then and then the next verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, explaining who the muttaqeen are, الَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ فِي السَّرَّاءِ وَالضَّرَّاءِ وَالْكَاظِمِينَ الْغَيْظِ وَالْعَافِينَ عَنِ النَّاسِ وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. They are those who donate in prosperity and adversity, control their anger, and pardon others. And Allah loves the good doers, right? It's really beautiful. So firstly, in the translation, they are those, it's not really necessary, it's redundant, because it's, you could say, it's paradise, this paradise, this garden, it's been prepared for the God-fearing, those who, you know, so it just follows on straight, naturally. It's, you know, you understand directly that this is a description of them. Alladhina yunfiqoon, those who spend. What do they give? Gold, silver, cash, whatever. It's not mentioned to broaden it. Like whatever there is to spend, whatever could be spent, they spend. Alladhina yunfiqoona fissarra'i, right, which comes from the word surur, happiness, wa-dharra, which comes from the word darar, harm. So in times of ease and difficulty, they spend. In times of happiness and sadness, they spend. In times of health and sickness, they spend. They're doing all of this to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all the time. So it can be interpreted in two ways. They're always spending, regardless of the situation, or they're spending in the most extreme situation, extreme emotions, the emotions of happiness, they're spending, and the emotions of pain and difficulty and sadness and suffering, they're spending then as well. يُنْفِقُونَ فِي السَّرَّاءِ وَالضَّرَّاءِ. And which, what does it do? It shows the strength of their ikhlas, the strength of their sincerity. وَصَدَقَةُ بُرْهَانُ, the Prophet said, and you know, charity is a proof that you're certain about the akhirah, that you're certain that you'll get these rewards promised to the believers. So that's the first quality mentioned about them, a tremendous quality. So it just shows their conviction in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and how that, you know, their hearts are attached to the akhirah, right? And they know that whatever they spend, it will they'll be rewarded for it. Now, it's a present tense verb, yunfiqoon. Time after time after time, when the opportunity comes, they do it. When the opportunity comes, they repeat the process. But then you've got the word وَالْكَاظِمِينَ الْغَيْظِ, and those who who suppress their rage, right? So rage, as we've said before, غَيْظ is an intense form of anger which occurs when someone does something bad in front of you, right? And so the word كَاظِم, كَظِم, it's really beautiful. Anyway, it's so kadham is basically, if you have a container that's replete, it's full, and then you tie up at the top when it's full, so nothing can come out. And The word kazim is when someone's so full of sadness and pain and emotion, right? It's like they're having to suppress it to keep it in. Dhun-noon is described like that. Wahu makdhum, one form of it, and then a very strong form of it was Sayyidina Ya'qub alayhi salatu wasalam. وَتَوَلَّى عَنْهُمْ فَقَالَ يَا أَسَفَ عَلَى يُوسُفَ وَبْيَضَّتْ عَيْنَاهُ مِنَ الْحُزْنِ وَهُوَ كَظِيمٌ. And he turned away from his sons, his family. وَقَالَ يَا أَسَفَ عَلَى يُوسُفَ. And he said, oh, my deep, deep grief over Yusuf. وَبْيَضَّتْ عَيْنَاهُ. And his eyes went white, meaning he got cataracts, right? And he was unable to see clearly, right? وَبْيَضَّتْ عَيْنَاهُ مِنَ الْحُزْنِ. Because of the grief it brought it on. فَهُوَ كَظِيم. And as a result, he was a kazim. So once, what's interesting is when a person's so full of pain and sadness and difficulty, what happens? You know, people say, I've got a lump in my throat, right? Or, you know, I think it's a thyroid gland on in the throat. It there's a physical sensation there, which is really interesting, given that the root word means to tie something, you know, up where it's completely replete. It's as though you're suppressing the sadness in that situation. But here, al-kadhim, so the rage and the anger at that moment, and it's on fa'il, it's active participle, so they're actively doing it, and this is their permanent state, right? So we this refers to, you know, also to the hadith now of, you know, the man who went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and asked for some advice. Awsini, he said, la taghdab, do not get angry. And scholars have explained that hadith in a couple of ways, one of them meaning don't let yourself get angry, right? The things that, the small and annoying things that, you know, would offend anyone else, you know, train yourself to just not be angered by them. Just let it go, right? And we see this with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Things of the dunya, related to the dunya, they didn't anger him. Only if someone, you know, crossed the limit of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would, you know, he'd get angry like that. And so, excuse me. So that's one meaning. Another meaning is, it's don't lash out. Don't vent your rage when you get angry. Don't control your reactions with it. So the first meaning, don't get angry. Don't let yourself get angry, be angered by certain things. And the second meaning is that if you do feel anger, and you know, don't direct it towards someone, right? Don't vent it on someone, right? So we've got an example of this in Ali ibn Hussein Zain al-Abidin, right? The great grandson of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he had a slave. She was pouring water for him, and he was making wudu, and the jug slipped and it hit his head, and so he got angry. Excuse me. He got angry. So she said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Wal kadhimin al-ghayz," those who suppress their anger. He said, okay, done. Then she said, "Wal afina an-nas," and those who pardon people, the next part of the verse. And he said, okay, done. I've forgiven you. Then she quoted the end of the verse, "Wallahu yuhibbul muhsinin," and Allah loves those who excel in goodness. And he said, okay, done. You're free. So he freed her. So this is what's being said. So it's a case of, you could say someone, when they're angered, they don't lash out at others, they don't yell at others, they don't scream, they don't get violent, right? And they don't swear, they don't descend to the baser forms of behavior with other people. Rather, yes, they're angry. And it's, you know, people have been created different. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created anger within us for a reason. There's a wisdom to it. One of them is to defend ourselves and defend those who are supposed to defend. And so it has a purpose, but when it's mismanaged, then it causes problems. So he said, well, they suppress that rage, right? And it's not even, it's like an intense form of anger. And and this requires training, and it's important for everyone to try and stay on top of it. The Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, laysa shadidu bi sur'a, that the hard man is not someone who can throw someone down. Innama shadidu man yamliku nafsahu and al ghadab. Clearly, the hard man, the strong person, is someone who can, who owns himself, as we said last time, ownership as a metaphor for control. The one, so clearly the hard person, the strong person, is someone who can control himself when he's angry, as in Sahih al-Bukhari. So this is what's intended. وَالْعَافِينَ عَنِ النَّاسِ. And then he says, sorry, the next bit, وَالْعَافِينَ عَنِ النَّاسِ, and those who pardon anyone, pardon people. So those who, from afu, which means to wipe something away. So someone who's wronged them, and then what they do, they wipe. They say, "You're forgiven. There's no more. You know, you won't be taken to task. It's you know, it's done. It's as though there's nothing there, nothing to forgive." Right, so al-afina aninas, and they forgive people. And he says nas, people, not just, you know, those that are close to them, or, you know, their friends, but even the enemies, right? Pardoning them. So you have to be ready to pardon, like someone who's being affected by another person's zulm at that moment, for them to not feel ready and not be able to forgive someone. That's understandable. And sometimes, for the sake of the other person, right, it's not wise to just say, okay, I forgive you, because what it can do is it can embolden the person who's wronging others to keep doing it, as we saw with the brothers of Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. When he first saw them after years, he didn't just go up to them and, you know, throw his arms around their necks and said, "My brothers, I've missed you, you know, I forgive you." Because what we saw is that they hadn't changed, they hadn't learned their lesson. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted them to go through a process, right, where they felt broken, and then they realized, you know what, we did do something wrong and we shouldn't have done it, right? Because what was their idea? Kill Yusuf or throw him in a far off land, وَطْرَحُوهُ أَرْضًا يَخْلُو لَكُمْ وَجْهُ أَبِيكُمْ, and the face of your father will be unblocked. So they thought that this is what the father's there, and Yusuf stood there in front of them, blocking the sight of them for their father, so all their father can see is him. And Sayyidina Yaqub was fair to his children, but rather it was the devil playing with them. So they were thinking, you know, he loves him more than us, and we need to get rid of him. And because they did it with such a heinous crime, even that they were bereft of. Like Sayyidina Yaqub, they didn't receive extra love and affection from Sayyidina Yaqub, because he knew they've done something, right? So they went, so he put them through a process for them to realize their mistakes. So if someone's actively wronging you, or they haven't learned their lesson, then for someone to not feel ready to forgive, you know, that takes time, right? But when a person does forgive someone who's wronged them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raises that person, as we know from the hadith in Sahih Muslim, where I believe the wording is مَا ظُلِمَ عَبْدٌ مَظْلَمَةً. No, that's another one. Anyway, the wording, it says that whenever someone who's been wronged pardons the other person, it does nothing but raise him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will raise this person higher in the sight of people. And it's one of the ways of, you know, getting closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? And so that's what he's saying. And then the next bit is saying, al-muhsineen, these people are those who excel, right? So there's a wisdom, there's a balance in how it's approached. So, but here he says, but generally, you know, small matters and things that, minor issues, the best thing is just pardon, just don't hold on to it, just, you know what, it's okay. And that's a form of sadaqah for yourself and on others, right? And you'll find that when you treat people like this, it comes back positively. So, wal afina aninas, and then it says, Wallahu yuhibbu al-muhsinin, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He loves those who excel in goodness. What is ihsan? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam described it as, أَنْتَعْبُدَ اللَّهَ كَأَنَّكَ تَرَاهُ, that you worship Allah as though you see Him. فَإِنْ لَمْ تَكُنْ تَرَاهُ فَإِنَّهُ يَرَاكَ, and if you don't see Him, then you know that He's seeing you. And that's the practical application of it. So what does it mean, al-ihsan? The ulama have two explanations. One is al-itqan, and the other is al-ijada. So perfection, so perfecting something that you do, doing it really well. And ijada is just excellence, right? Just being, you know, doing something, being an excellent action and doing it well, right? So Allah loves these people, and doing these things, I think, are actions that leads to the love of Allah. And that is one of the greatest things you can triumph with in this life, to be someone who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves. And these people are the muttaqeen, right? So in fact, the highest levels of the muttaqeen. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us this. And then it says, الَّذِينَ وَالَّذِينَ إِذَا فَعَلُوا فَاحِشَةً أَوْ ظَلَمُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ ذَكَرُوا اللَّهَ فَاسْتَغْفِرُوا لِذُنُوبِهِمْ وَمَنْ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ. There are those who, upon committing an evil deed or wronging themselves, remember Allah and seek forgiveness and do not knowingly persist in it. وَلَمْ يُصِرُوا عَلَى مَا فَعَلُوا وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ. And he's changed the order in the translation. And who forgives sins except Allah? So what we have here is there's two positions regarding this. One position is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about two groups of people: those who excel in goodness, the muttaqeen, and then those, you could say, the ta'ibin, those who, so the first group do their best to shun evil and sins. The second group fall into them, but they make tawbah, right? But and then that's one position. And the second position is that it's all talking about one group and just different states. They do excellence, and you know, Allah loves those who excel. And then even those who excel, if when they make mistakes and they fall into sin, this is how what they respond with, right? This is how they react. So وَالَّذِينَ, and those who do, right? So this is why it can be interpreted as being one group, or the waw could be made to, and it can be understood as this is a separate group with the waw. So these and those, or the waw could be understood as it's this other quality is their quality, but it's so special and distinctive that it deserves its own category. It deserves to be mentioned as though it's something separate, even though it's the same group, right? إِذَا فَعَلُوا فَاحِشَةً, and when they do, so the word فَعَلُوا, it's the فَعَلَ, it comes like a word, it happens quickly with ease. It's not pre-planned, not premeditated, they mess up, right? And they don't really want to be doing this, right? فَاحِشَةً, something vile and disgusting, extreme in being terrible and disgusting, like zina, right? As the example that the ulama gave. أَوْ ظَلَمُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ, or they wronged themselves. Now, doing a fahisha, like committing zina, waliyadhu billah, is a form of wronging yourself. But we go from a specific to a general. So whether it's the worst thing or any other smaller things, right? Any harm that they do to themselves through the sinning, what do? ذَكَرُ اللَّهَ, they remember Allah, they remember His threat, they remember the punishment, they remember His promise of forgiveness for those who turn back to Him, they remember He deserves so much more in His slaves than, you know, what they've been manifesting through their actions. They remember that He deserves their obedience and devotion. So what do? فَاسْتَغْفَرُوا لِذُنُوبِهِمْ, they ask for forgiveness, and in brackets, protection and, you know, concealment, protection and cover for their dhunub. So dhamb is a sin that is followed by a punishment, right? So they remember that, and they ask for forgiveness for these sins to be protected for them. And then he's got a beautiful expression, وَمَنْ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ, And who forgives sins except for Allah, the Supreme Being, the ultimate God? Right? He decides, right? So it's very different from the Christian understanding that, you know, there's been an original sin or these sins, and the only way you can do it, that they're so heinous that it requires a sacrifice, it requires a death, you know, the blood to wash away the sin. So that's what, you know, and then, you know the belief. And so we say, no, God is in charge. He decides what is right, what is wrong, what should be rewarded, what should be pardoned, and what should be punished, right? So it's up to him. No one can dictate anything to him. So he says, so who forgives sins except for Allah? And, you know, the answer is, you know, clearly no one, right? And the answer comes from ourselves. So it's a question which can only have one answer. So when we answer it, it hits harder. Like, yeah, no one forgives sins except for Allah. And then he continues, وَلَمْ يُصِرُّوا عَلَى مَا فَعَلُوا وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ. And they don't persist, they don't stubbornly persist in what they've done knowingly, that this is something terrible, this is something bad. And, you know, so what about the people who make mistakes and, you know, they're stuck in it, right? Sometimes, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests people with a particular sin and they just keep falling into their sin over and over. So the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, la kabirata ma'al istighfar, there's no enormity, no major sin with istighfar. You've done that, you've fallen into the sin, you ask for forgiveness, it's gone, right? And wala saghirata ma'al israr, and there's no minor sins, and there's no minor sin with persistence. Like someone who does a small minor sin, he keeps doing it, it becomes a major sin because there's persistence in it. But there's another narration that contextualizes ma asarra man istaghfara, the one who asks for forgiveness is not persisting in the sin. And the word israr is connected to the stubbornness of a donkey, right? So they can be very stubborn animals. So it's like someone who knowingly, willingly, doesn't care, just throws himself into it again and again and again. He's told, look, stop it, it's not good for you, it's bad for you, but he just does it anyway. Right? وَلَا أَصَرَّ مَنْ إِسْتَغْفَرَ وَمَا أَصَرَّ مَنْ إِسْتَغْفَرَ وَإِنْ عَادَ فِي الْيَوْمِ سَبْعِينَ مَرَّةً. And even if he returns to the sin 70 times a day, right? So he makes his sins, and then he sincerely asks for forgiveness, oh Allah, forgive me, and then he botches it up again, he falls into the sin again, and he sincerely asks for forgiveness. And this is the relationship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us, that there's always tawbah and istighfar, that is, you ask for forgiveness and you turn back to Allah, even if you keep falling into the sin. Because what happens eventually, the sins fall away, right? With the sincere repentance, the things that you might be doing, they will diminish, right, in number, in frequency, until they're not there anymore, right? So it's very important to sincerely. And that's why, you know, if someone's stuck in a sin, stuck in a lifestyle of sin, just say to them, no, just go and say sorry. Ask Allah for forgiveness, and, you know, just sincerely ask for forgiveness and say, I won't do it again. Do your best, and then if you fall into it again, the same lifestyle, same people, keep going back. Keep going back, keep turning back to Allah. And that's where the change happens, right? So then he says, knowing the consequences and knowing how terrible the thing is, right? They don't do this, right? And, you know, if someone does this israr, then they ask for forgiveness. And as the Prophet said in the hadith of Abu Dawud and Tirmidhi, that with tawbah and istighfar, it won't be considered to be this israr, this stubborn persistence. And then he says, ulaika, those amazing, excellent people. So the meaning of being distant, high, far off in greatness, jaza'uhum, those people, their reward, their recompense is as though, you know, subhanAllah, Allah's honoring us, right? Despite the mistakes we make, despite the sins that we have, it's like He's still, you know, ready to pardon us, right? Jazaohum maghfiratum min rabbihim. This tremendous, supreme forgiveness from their loving Lord, as we talked about earlier. Wa jannatun. And many, many gardens. So gardens within paradise, right? Tajri min tahtiha al-anhar. We've explained this in the past, which basically it means that you have the gardens which have trees, and above the trees are the is all the foliage from the branches and everything. That's the Jannah, that covers everything beneath it. So beneath those trees are these many rivers that flow, right? Khalidina fiha, they will be there forever. So not only do they get a tremendous reward, but they be there permanently. Right, so any gift, any enjoyment that you have in the dunya, it ends, right? But imagine the best enjoyment that never loses its, you know, sparkle, right? It just keeps, it's just more and more enjoyable the more you engage in this action, and you get to do it forever. You get to be there with those people who you love, and enjoying yourself in the best way forever, right? Wa ni'ma ajrul amilin, and what an excellent reward it is, right? So in Arabic, there's something implied here. It can be implied as, and what an excellent reward the forgiveness, or actually, as Imam Al-Usi puts it, what an excellent reward the forgiveness, sorry, the garden is for those who work, al-amilin. So there's a further encouragement here that don't you sit there and think, oh, I'll be forgiven. No, okay, you might be forgiven, great, but there's more chance of it if you're acting like you're someone who wants forgiveness through good deeds, through further good deeds, through further works. That's one thing. And the second thing is the rewards that you get in this paradise will be greater with more effort, with more work. So the point is to draw closer to Allah. Do things that please Him through excellence to Allah, through in worshipping Him and seeking to please Him. Yeah, through good deeds and excellence through to His creation. These things lead to this, right? So this is basically what's been said so far regarding these verses. And now what happens is we go into more detail, as Sayyid Tantawi mentions, we go into more detail about the event at Uhud and and the lesson that can be learned from there, because there was a defeat, and there are lessons to be learned, and we see some of the wisdoms why these difficulties occur. Right, so we'll continue from there, inshallah ta'ala. Allah bless you all. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Okay, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.